Now we come back to where we left, and we will now look at exercises 3, which are essentially based on steam, except a few in between which are based on equation of state other than van der Waals gas, that is other than steam, that is on van der Waals gas. Okay. If you just go through, you will find that the exercises 3.1, 3.2 and 3.3, these are essentially warm up exercises for the students to get used to steam tables, except that there are a few exceptions which I will mention. So we come to exercises based on steam, that is set 3. 3.1 and 3.2 ask you to determine the state given two properties, and it is good idea to not, for example, in 3.2 it is asked, classify the following states of 1 kg of water substance as wet, dry saturated, superheated, steam, subcooled, liquid, etc., etc. You should also extend this by saying and determine all other relevant properties, so that they do not just stop by saying subcooled liquid, but they also calculate other properties. Now some of these, for example, the first two, maybe I should go here and show it here. In 3.2, the first two, pressure, temperature, pressure, temperature, it is directly based on the phase plot. So just look at the saturation line and you can determine whether it is subcooled liquid, superheated vapor or saturated liquid. Then you have a few others where it is pressure and some property other than temperature. Similarly, pressure, some property other than temperature, pressure, some property other than temperature, temperature, some property other than pressure. Okay. And of course, this is another one. So here, one property is P or T and the other property is either V or U or H or S. Then one should realize by looking at a study of the steam tables, that if say this property is phi, let me use the symbol phi for any one of these properties, then it turns out that phi of subcooled liquid is less than phi of saturated liquid, is less than phi of wet steam, is less than phi of dry sat vapor, is less than phi of superheated steam. When the pressure or temperature is below critical, above the critical temperature it is only a single phase, so it does not matter. And based on this, for example, pressure 2 bar, internal energy 6.2 kilo joule per Kelvin, but since it is given 1 kilogram, specific entropy will be 6.2 kilo joule per kilogram Kelvin. You go to the steam tables and you will notice that at 2 bar, since the pressure is provided, let us go to the pressure based table. And at 2 bar, you will find that the saturated liquid enthalpy is 1.530, dry saturated vapor, sorry, entropy is 7.127, the value needed is 6.2 kilo joule per kilogram Kelvin, which lies in between these two, so it is wet vapor. If the value were less than 1.530, it would be subcooled liquid. If the value were to be higher than 7.127 kilo joule per kilogram Kelvin, it would be superheated steam. If it were exactly this, then saturated liquid, exactly then dry saturated vapor. Since it lies in between, you can determine the dryness fraction first, and from the dryness fraction using these other values, all other properties. Okay. So, these cases C, similarly D, also H and also G can be handled this way, because one of the two properties given is pressure or temperature, and the second property is one of these four. And mind you, since density is the reciprocal of specific volume, if you use densities, it would be the other way around, but fortunately for us, densities are not tabulated. So, it is a good idea to tell the students that as far as possible in thermodynamics, work with specific volumes, because the trends of specific volume are similar to trend of U, H and S. If you have to work with density, remember that it is a reciprocal of specific volume, so the trends would just be the other way around. And another reason is, most of the steam tables will tabulate only specific volumes, because the basic formulation is in terms of PVT, okay, not P rho T. There is one case here where temperature is 100 degrees C and dryness fraction is 0.8. Temperature is 100 degrees C, dryness fraction is 0.8. Here it is obviously wet steam because dryness fraction is directly given. Okay. Again, sometimes the students have a mental set that 0 is the dryness fraction of liquid, saturated liquid, 1 is the dryness fraction of dry saturated vapor. So, if you substitute in that formula, they will say superheated vapor has a dryness fraction greater than 1. Subcooled liquid has a dryness fraction less than 1. You should tell them that this is meaningless. Dryness fraction is not defined for subcooled liquid and not defined for superheated vapor. Okay. So, a dryness fraction, a formula will give you a value. It is a formula, that is not thermodynamics. Okay. Formula will give you a value for superheated steam, dryness fraction of more than 1. Subcooled water, dryness fraction less than 0. But that is meaningless, that is not meaningful at all. So, that is what you should impress on. Now, here there are two cases E and F. One is specific enthalpy of 2900 kilo joule per kilogram Kelvin and specific entropy of 6.2 kilo joule, sorry, enthalpy of 2900 kilo joule per kilogram, entropy of 6.2 kilo joule per kilogram Kelvin. 1 kg, so these are also the specific values. A similar value here, 2500 kilo joule per kg, 8.8 kilo joule per kg K. Since this is enthalpy and entropy, it is not easy to find out the state directly from the steam tables. Okay. I have kept these two just to get used to some general characteristics of steam. For example, if you look at E. Let us come to the pressure table, and it is good to point out to them that if you look at the specific enthalpy of dry saturated steam HG, you will notice that the values start from 2501.4 at triple point. They go on increasing and you will find something funny. They increase up to 7 bar, 2763.5, 2799.5, but on this page you will notice 2800.5 going up to 2804.2 and again decreasing. Okay. So, the enthalpy increases and then decreases for dry saturated steam, and the highest value found is at 30 bar. 2804.2 kilo joule per kilogram. Okay. Since our value is 2900 kilo joule per kilogram, there is no way it can be subcooled or wet vapor. It cannot even be dry saturated vapor. It will be some pressure, some temperature, which is in the superheated domain. So that is what here superheated steam, but when it comes to determining the properties, you will have to hunt it out in the superheated table and do a two-dimensional interpolation. Maybe at this stage it is good to introduce them to the enthalpy entropy diagram. But there are a few difficulties here. I am putting it here, but it won't be, only a small part will be seen. So we open it out. There are two problems here. First thing is a minor problem is that enthalpy entropy are non-standard coordinates. Not even one of them is P or T. Entropy is a property which is not known to them. So what we tell them is this. If you plot against P or T, V, U, H, S, any one of them, either P or T here or V, U, H, S here, the general characteristic is like this, with the critical point always at the top. This is a general characteristic. That means you have an inverted dome with the critical point at the top. The relative slope of this side and this side may be different. It is possible that this side may even go back like this, as in case of enthalpy. Okay. In case of, for example, pH diagram, it is very clear and we have seen it. Enthalpy increases and then decreases to the critical enthalpy. So this could be here, this could be here, but it is an inverted dome, a crooked inverted dome. And sometimes this will be sharper, this will be very shallow. For example, if you take P and V, this is very sharp, whereas this is very shallow. Okay. But when it comes to enthalpy entropy, first thing, why do we plot enthalpy and entropy? That will be clear when you complete the study of second law. The importance of entropy will be clear. And when you study open systems, the importance of enthalpy will be clear. And hence for open systems, some like turbines, compressors, boilers, the enthalpy entropy diagram is of great significance. And that is why it is plotted. So on the enthalpy entropy diagram, if you plot the full entropy entropy diagram, entropy enthalpy, for example, if this is triple point pressure or temperature, and if you say this is our triple point, the saturated line, that is the liquid vapor line, goes something like this. This line from here to here gets mapped onto this, and this dome gets mapped in a very crooked way like this. This shape may not be correct, but all this zone, critical point and all that, gets mapped in a very small zone here. So small that it becomes very difficult to read at any scale. And that is why what is plotted on the enthalpy entropy diagram at the end of your steam tables is essentially a subpart which is something like this. You will see a diagonal line going, this line going across like this. That is, although it is written saturation line, it is the dry saturated vapor line. The critical point will be somewhere here on the enthalpy entropy diagram. It is not on the top, it is somewhere on the left, it is out of this. Okay. And again you will notice that at around 30 bar we have the maximum enthalpy, dry saturated vapor enthalpy, and then it decreases on either side of that point. Okay. And our value of 2900 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. And what was the entropy? 6.2 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. This is the point in the state space that we were looking at. That gives you roughly the idea where it lies. So if you look at it, these are the constant temperature lines. So this point is somewhere between 280 and 290 degree C, and these are the constant pressure lines. So this pertains to 50 bar, this pertains to 40 bar. So we are very near the 45 bar line. So that allows us to, you know, reduce our trial and error zone if you really want to determine the properties by interpolation. And if you look at the next thing, enthalpy of 2500 kilojoule per kg, entropy of 8.8 kilojoule per kg Kelvin, you will notice 2500 is here, 8.8 is here. So you are out here, which is wet zone. Again, in wet zone, you notice that we have it in terms of enthalpy and entropy. So again, you will have to interpolate between pressure lines or temperature lines to get the required values. 3.3 is similar, except that we are talking of. If U is mentioned, unfortunately, you will have to work only with tables. In H and S, at least we have a diagrammatic representation in the Mollier diagram. But if you have to, suppose you are analyzing a situation where quite a number of times U and S would be the variables, then you will sit with a steam table and a plotter and plot your US diagram. It will be similar to the HS diagram. You will plot the US diagram, so you will get a feel for it and then start working with it. Because, you know, that is what we tell our students, that a figure is worth 1000 words. So a figure simplifies a lot. So if you have to work with U and S, you will have to do 1000 searches of the steam table. So plot it once and your searches from 1000 will reduce to 2 or 3. Now coming to 3.3, the only thing is here there are two states provided. You are given an initial state, a final state, and the link between the two states. So you have to first find out the, for example, in A, initial state is given as P1 is 5 bar, V1 is 0.3 meter cube per kg. And the process is constant volume. So V2 is also equal to V1, but P2 is 3 bar. So instead of 1, you have to determine 2 points, find out 2 properties and find out differences in them, because this is also something that they will be doing quite often. For the time being, we will skip 3.4, 3.5, 3.6, 7, 8 and 9, okay, and some parts of later problem which pertain to van der Waals gas. Time permitting, we will come to that. Otherwise, we will solve them in an offline mode when the Moodle session is on. Now, let us start solving some problems, and first we will look at 3.11, then we will look at 3.14, then we will look at 3.12, we quickly see what each the characteristic of each of these problems are. So we will first look at 3.11. Since we have solved a number of problems using first law yesterday, the basic discussion of first law we will not do. We will assume that we are comfortable with it. We will quickly see what differences we have to come across, we will face when we look at steam. First thing, remember, steam is nowhere near an ideal gas. It can condense, it can vaporize. So du equals Cv dt, dh equals Cp dt is an absolute no-no. Similarly, Pv equal to Rt is an absolute no-no. I am so cranky about this that for a steam, if a student like any one of this, I draw a red mark there and I will not look further in that answer at all. That means you have not really noticed that it is a problem with water and steam and not with some ideal gas.
For superheated region, that idea.
You have the tables. Yes. So you have to use. There is absolutely no reason to use PV equals RT for any part of steam. Absolutely no reason. Particularly in a course in thermodynamics. Of course, you can use that if you ask a student that look, people say that at low pressures and high temperatures, steam like any gas is expected to behave like an ideal gas. So at a pressure of 0.5 bar and 600 degrees C, find out the volume of steam as predicted, assuming it to be an ideal gas. In fact, something like that is there in the van der Waals gas problems. Instead of ideal gas, we are asking it to be compared to a van der Waals gas. But such comparison, if you want to do, then he can use ideal gas equation for steam to get the volume as predicted by the ideal gas equation and compare it with the volume as given by steam. Yes, but in that the vapor pressures are so small, they are a very small fraction of the atmosphere. The temperature region is small, so that becomes a suitable approximation. But in principle, in psychrometry, you can use the ideal gas equation or relations for the vapor part, steam table, sorry, for the gas part, steam table for the vapor part, and you need not ever open the psychrometric chart. With these two, you can do all your psychrometric calculations. They may be a bit cumbersome, but they are, from a thermodynamic point of view, they are more robust and they are more neat. They may not be more accurate because we know in that range it is a good approximation. But remember, there we do not calculate Cp as Cp minus Cv is R and Cp by Cv is gamma. We calculate Cp by fitting a curve and say, let the mean Cp be something like 1.88 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. So there is a data fit used there. Okay? So a full ideal gas relation is not used. Okay. So coming to 3.11, you have 2 kg of steam at critical conditions sealed in a rigid container. Rigid container immediately means no PdV work, constant volume process. It is then placed inside an oven at 349.9 degrees C and allowed to reach thermal equilibrium. So that means it is given that initial condition is critical state, final condition is the same value as the value of volume as the initial state, rigid container, final temperature is 349.9 degrees C. Okay. So initial state is given, final state is given. Determine the masses of water and steam in the final state and the heat transfer. So we start with the system diagram, rigid container. So I just show a box, let us say this is my system, it contains 2 kg. Initially at the critical point. And what do? I put it in an oven which is at 349.9 degrees C. And we definitely know that the temperature is higher than 349.9 degrees C, something like 374. The temperature will reduce. We expect some heat transfer to take place. But we expect W expansion to be 0. There is no stirrer, so we expect even W other to be 0. This is an assumption. This comes out of the fact that it is a rigid container. And we say let there be some heat transfer Q. Notice that the value of Q may turn out to be positive or may be negative, but the arrow of Q we will always show into the system because that is the default positive direction. Now, since it is a fluid and in particular since a constant volume process is specified, we will sketch the process on the PV diagram. The initial state 1 is given to be critical point. the final state is given to be a temperature of 349.9 degrees C. So let me plot an isotherm of 349.9 degrees C. It will go something like this. This is T, 349.9 degrees C. It is a constant volume process, so the final state will be on this line. And at 349.9 degrees C, so this is the final state. This is the final state, state 2. And in terms of specific volume, V2 equals V1 is V critical point. So we know the initial state fully, properties at the critical point. We know the final state fully in terms of specific volume and temperature. So all other properties as needed can be determined. So we have to determine the masses of water and steam in the final state and the heat transfer. Simple enough. We know total mass is 2 kg. We know V2 is V1 is VCP. Read it out from the steam tables, critical point. So end of table 1 or end of table 2, your choice. If I go to end of table 2, you will find VF and VG are both listed, but they have equal value. So this is 0.003155 meter cube per kg. Then you notice that T2 is 349.9 degrees C. I think this is given because although it is not a, this is I think historic, because earlier the saturation table in this set of steam tables stopped at 100, but now you have a 350 degree C line there. But here you look up the table 2, you have a temperature of 349.9 degrees C, saturation temperature pressure of 165 bar. Okay. But that is not the issue. We now notice that our state is now provided in terms of V2 and T2. So we use this formulation for specific volume. And we notice immediately that at 349.9 degrees C, what is VF and what is VG? At 349.9 degrees C, we will notice VF is 001740 meter cube per kilogram, VG is 0.00883. Where does V2 lie? V2 lies in between. You said VF at 2 is less than V2 is less than VG at 2. Hence, 2 is wet steam. Force the students to write this. Once it is wet steam, then you can calculate X2 is V2 minus VF2 divided by VG2 minus VF2. Okay. I have used commas here, so I should also have commas here. And that means you calculate X2. Once you calculate X2, well, from here it is straightforward. Mass of water. Mass of water in the final state 2 is 1 minus X2 into the total mass. Mass of steam in the final state 2 is X2 into the total mass. So one part of the answer we can calculate. The second part of the answer is the heat transferred. Naturally, for heat transfer, we have to use first law. Don't think of anything else. The moment you have to determine heat transfer, means it has to be delta E plus W. Start with this. What about W? It is given that it is a rigid container, so W expansion is 0. There is no hint of any other work mode, so we have assumed W other to be 0. That brings us to the conclusion that W is 0. The whole thing is sitting still in a furnace, not moving up and down or accelerating, decelerating. So we will assume delta E to be equal to delta U. We will assume other components to be 0. Okay. Let the students, at least for the initial few problems, go through this and write it down. And delta U is nothing going to be M into U2 minus U1. U1 can be read off from steam tables. It is already there tabulated, 2029.6 kilojoule per kg at critical point. And U2 is obtained from X2, UF2 and UG2. UF2, UG2 read off from the steam table, X2 already computed. Mass is given, if you know this, you know Q. Okay. Now let us look at 3.14. We have water at some temperature pressure. It executes a constant pressure process, absorbing heat. The amount of heat absorbed is given. Determine the final state of the system in terms of enthalpy, dryness fraction, temperature. System is a closed one, that is a tautology. We are only looking at closed system. Okay, 3.14. Since it is expanding, we should show it by means of a cylinder piston arrangement. The initial state is 100 degrees C and 6 bar, and since it is going to remain at constant pressure, we can show P equals 6 bar, that will always remain. And since everything is per kg, let us assume the mass to be m kg. Everything will be in terms of m, but properties will not depend on it. A Q is provided, and Q is given to be m into 1500 kilojoule per kg. The state space. We can draw PV, does not matter. Expansion works, so PV is a good idea. Let us say that this is the saturated liquid line, this is the trisaturated vapor line. And we are given that it is 6 bar. So the whole process will take place on this line of 6 bar. The initial state is given at 6 bar 100 degrees C. When that happens, you should immediately check what is the saturation temperature at 6 bar. At 6 bar, you will notice that the saturation temperature is 158.9 degrees C. Okay. Our temperature is below that, 100. So we have subcooled liquid. Or you can say at 100 degrees C, what is the saturation pressure? Our pressure will be higher than that. Either way, you will come to the conclusion that it is subcooled liquid. So if you plot 100 degrees C line, it will go something like this. And so this will be our initial state, state 1. It is subcooled liquid. So using the subcooled liquid model, I mean incompressible liquid model, we know how to calculate the properties H, U, V, S as appropriate. Now it absorbs heat and expands at constant pressure. So the process will go something like this. It will end up somewhere, we do not know, let it end up in some 2. At this stage we do not know whether 2 is in the subcooled liquid zone or wet zone or exact dry saturated vapor or superheated vapor, but it is somewhere on that line. And now we have to determine the final state of the system, and of course it is not us, but we have to, we can determine even the amount of work done, because once we start this we know what is what all can be done. We know initial state fully. We do not know the final state, except that at the final state the pressure is going to be 6 bar. So, one part of the final state is known. So, we have to determine some other property. Now, instead of some other property, here an interaction is provided. Q is 1000 kilojoule per kilogram. So, the other property, remember, heat is related, heat interaction is related to work done and change in energy. That is the only relation between heat interaction and change in a property. So, to make use of that information, we will have to use first law. So, we start with first law. Delta U we will keep as delta U, but W expansion, it is a constant pressure process. So, integral P dV, assuming it to be quasi-static, and since it is constant pressure process, a quasi-static assumption is in order. If it is not in order, we cannot proceed. So, it becomes P delta V, and since it is a constant pressure process, you can write this as delta PV, because P is constant, I can take it inside delta, and then I can write it as again because of this, and this is delta H, which by definition of H. So, notice what we noticed yesterday. Yesterday we said that in a constant pressure process, Q equals delta H only when the work done is only expansion work, no other work, and delta E is delta U. We are finding it here. Okay. If you are knowledgeable, experienced, you could straight away say Q equals delta H because delta E must be delta U and there is no other work other than expansion work. But only when you understand. So now Q is provided. Q is 1500 kilojoule, kilojoule per kilogram multiplied by m. This is delta H, which we write as mass into H2 minus H1. Mass cancels out, this and this. So, we have H2 equals H1 plus 1500 kilojoule per kg. At this time, I will leave the rest to you. So, state 2 now gets defined in terms of P2 and H2. Then determine whether it is wet steam. I think it turns out to be wet steam in this case. Determine dryness fraction if it is wet steam. Determine other properties. If you want to determine work done, P into delta V will be the work done. Okay. So, with this we conclude this problem. The calculation I leave to you. Now, let us look at 3.12. Now, in 3.12, we are told that some saturated liquid at a given pressure is mixed with 1 kg of superheated steam at 12 bar, same pressure notice, and 300 degrees C. The mixing is adiabatic and at constant pressure. Notice it is very clearly given that it is adiabatic and constant pressure. You should not object to it because this is possible. Determine the changes in volume and internal energy, the dryness fraction in the final state, and work done. Exercise 3.12. We have 2 kg saturated liquid at 12 bar mixed with 1 kg of superheated steam at what temperature? 300 degrees C, 12 bar. You have a process adiabatic plus isobaric. We have no difficulty with isobaric because the initial pressure of both components is 12 bar. So, the initial pressure of the system you can also call is 12 bar. So, that means if this is the state 1A and this is the state 1B, the state 2 will be such that P2 will be 12 bar. That conclusion we already have come to. Now, how do you sketch the system diagram and the process diagram? This is where some explanation is ordered to students. Let us say that we have a cylinder piston arrangement and we have a thin partition here separating it into two parts. This is our piston and the whole thing is adiabatic. For the whole system, Q is 0. Let us say this is the part 1A and this is the part 1B. Initially nothing happens. This is a thin insulated partition just to keep the two separate. It can be thin because pressures on either side are the same, but it better be a thermal resistor, not a conductor, so that 2 kg saturated liquid at 12 bar, the temperature at 12 bar is 188.0 C, whereas at other side it is 300 degrees C. So, let us assume that there is such a partition which keeps them separate. And of course, there is a piston to take care of any changes in volume during mixing. And we say that the process is begun by removing this partition. I can do it like this. Ah, great. Oh, no, this should not be. And now instead of 1A and 1B, finally it ends up at 2. Okay. Now, how do you depict the process on a PV diagram? Notice that I am showing P specific volume V so that the masses do not matter. And since the action takes place at 12 bar, we have 1A initially here, saturated liquid at 12 bar. And if this is the dry saturated vapor line, 300 degrees C will be here, 1B, because we know that this temperature is how much? 188 Celsius. So, if you want, you can show an isotherm going through this, that will be 188 degrees C. So, this part between 1A and this point will be at 188 degrees C. The state 2 will lie somewhere here. I am showing it approximately in the wet zone, but it could be anywhere in the wet zone or even in the superheated zone depending on the relative masses of 1A and 1B. Here 1A has a large mass, 1B has a small mass, so maybe it will be wet. You agree that if instead of 2 kg and 1 kg, if it were 2 kg and 0.1 kg, we would have said almost wet, where it were 2 kg and 200 kg, we would have said, well, it's most likely superheated. But it is 2 and 1, so we don't know, but let's assume it to be 2, just for. Now, it is possible that the process takes place like this, but that would indicate that 1B comes to 2, 1A comes to 2, and then they sort of come in equilibrium. But the process does not really take place like that. When the partition is removed, the pressure is the same. So, there will be no immediate mixing, but the temperatures are different. So, there will be some amount of heat transfer taking place. Maybe because of the resulting thing, the volumes will change. What we will assume is that throughout the process, the pressure remains at 12 bar, isobaric. And we will assume that the process is quasi-static. This is very slippery. This is an assumption, and in this particular case, it is a significant assumption. Because although we can say that the pressure is being maintained constant, quasi-static means that there are not going to be sudden and jerky jumps in volume. That is what it means. So, although these two arrows are not a real depiction, something like that will happen. The changes in volume would be such that the piston from here will go to the final volume in a reasonably smooth way. So, that at any time we photograph it, we see no significant velocity, no significant acceleration. Now, how do you relate state 2 to state 1? One specification is isobaric, another specification is adiabatic. Adiabatic means heat transfer is 0. Take it as heat transfer specified to be 0. So, just as in the earlier problem, we wrote Q equals delta E plus W, here also we write Q equals delta E plus W. Then we say, because it is adiabatic, Q is 0, we make an assumption that no other component other than delta U, and we make an assumption that there will be volume changes, so there will be pressure changes, sorry, work done by expansion, but we will assume W to be W expansion. Okay. And again we will say that since W expansion takes place at constant pressure, this will be represented by P into V2 minus V1, and by our earlier thing, this will finally come to delta H, the same step as in the previous problem. So, the whole thing finally reduces to delta H equals 0. And this we expand as equal to H2 minus H1 and write it as H2 equal to M2 H2 equal to H1, which is M1A H1A plus M1B H1B, where 1A and 1B are the two parts. So, M1A is 2 kg, M1B is 1 kg. And obviously, we always have conservation of mass. So, along with this comes M2 is M1A plus M1B. Now, at this stage, we know M2 because M1A and M1B are known. We know everything about states 1A and 1B. So, we know H1A, H1B. So, we know H2 because M2 has already been calculated. That means state 2 is available to us in terms of P2 and H2. And that means we know everything about state 2. The moment we know everything about state 2, we can determine V2 minus V1, work done, change in internal energy, change in change in enthalpy has already been given as 0, but anything else that you want to calculate, you can calculate. Remember that what you have to do here is that major assumption that it is a quasi-static process. And the quasi-static process here means, since pressure is already given, we do not expect during a quasi-static mixing process jerky or sudden changes in volume. So, the expansion work can be written down as P delta V. If there are sudden changes in volume, that may not be true. Okay, then it is a non-quasi-static and we cannot proceed with solving the problem. Yes, sir.
If the mixing is carried out in a rigid container, then
mixing is carried out in
rigid container instead of that piston cylinder arrangement.
Right.
Then there is no question of work done, expansion work, etc.
Yes, we have a problem like that.
So in this case, it is not directly written that mixing is carried out in piston cylinder arrangement. I can take into assumption that it should be carried out in the rigid container.
Then if you carry it out in the rigid container, you cannot expect it to be a constant pressure.
Pressure is going to remain constant, sir.
How? In a rigid container, what will you do to maintain the pressure constant? Remember that it is given to be adiabatic. So you can't say that I am heating it to maintain the pressure constant. But how will it evaporate to maintain pressure constant? You are giving a rigid container, so you are saying no change in volume. Okay? Wait. Let me come to this. If you are saying a rigid container, that means you are excluding expansion work, you are excluding other type of work also, so there is no work interaction. Okay? You are saying it is adiabatic, so there is no heat interaction. So you are saying there is no change in energy. Okay? So there is going to be no change in energy, there is going to be no change in volume. Based on this, your final pressure will be dictated. The problem will reduce to V2 is V1 because of rigid container, and U2 is U1 because adiabatic and rigid container means no expansion work, other work anyway is assumed to be 0. And that is exactly the problem 3.15. Slightly different, but you can have a sub problem of 3.15. A rigid metallic container is separated into two equal parts by volume by a thin partition. One part contains 1 kg of saturated liquid at 100 degrees C. The other part is evacuated. For simplicity, the other part is M equals 0, a very special case. The partition is broken and equilibrium re-established after some time. Now here is the difference. During the process, the temperature of the system is maintained by immersing it in an oil bath maintained at 100 degrees C. Like that critical pressure problem which we first looked at, 3.11. But I can have a different problem saying during the process, the temperature during the process, the rigid container is adiabatic. So here, because it is in a oil bath maintained at 100 degrees C, I know the final temperature. But if I say adiabatic, I won't even know the final temperature. Determine what the state is. We can do that. I think there is a problem of, yes, 3.17 is exactly, you need trial and error. Previous problem is which number? 3.14, the one which we have solved just now. Okay.
The entropy
No. How do you decide that for a quasi-static process entropy change is 0? That means I can execute any process quasi-statically and all quasi-static processes will become isentropic processes. That's not true. No, we have not even defined what is a reversible process. Quasi-static only means that I can trace it nicely through the state space. When we come to reversible, we will realize that for a process to be reversible, it definitely has to be quasi-static, but the other way is not true. For example, a process, later on we will see, a process of stirring, so long as you stir it very slowly, it is a quasi-static process, but it is nowhere near a reversible process, it is just not reversible. Okay.
First part is mentioned as a quasi-static. In the book, it is later it is mentioned as a reversible.
Like then there is something wrong there. Don't ever assume that everything in a book is true. Challenge that. As one of my professors, Professor Achyutan, says, that don't accept any statement without challenging it, including this statement of mine. Okay, so we meet after lunch.